Good morning, everyone. I think we're still good morning. Yes, it's good morning still, just about. For those of you who are not here for our first session on the programming experts, may I welcome you on behalf of MIPTV to this, our 50th anniversary of the market. My name is Chris Forrester. I'm a journalist working in London and specializing in all things visual, particularly 4K. And we're here to look at television's next revolution, the shift from standard definition through high definition to ultra-high definition and the 4K symbol. Many, many thanks to our sponsors, Sony and SES, without whom we could not have put this session together. Don't hesitate to have a close look outside at the 84-inch display from Sony, some stunning imagery upon that. We'll also be using Sony's 5RX515P, which is up in the projection booth, a 4,000-line projector, really neat device. Again, it didn't require us to knock walls down in the Palais this year. Again, thank you to the technical crews. You know who you are, guys. I couldn't be up here and we couldn't be doing what we're doing without all of your help and support and expertise. Our second session looks at the technologists and looks at some of the challenges that they've had to face. And in fact, our first speaker, Berti Kropac, from Kropac Media, who did some of the footage, created some of the footage on that Sky Deutschland demo we saw a few moments ago. Poor Berti Kropac has worked about 1 million hours over the last 3 days to try and get footage here of his latest shoot. He can't. It doesn't work. But it's not through lack of his effort or lack of the crew's effort. But might I invite Berti? Berti, come up onto the stage, because we're going to talk to some of his challenges. He is a cameraman. He has been responsible for some fantastic work. And let's use the clicker, Berti, and sit yourself down.
Yes, hello.
Welcome and apologies again that the hard work. What Berti has done has pulled some or made some stills from some of the video footage. And what we thought we would do for a few moments is to cover some of the challenges and some of the projects and some of the clients that you've been working with this last year, again with an F65 camera. Shooting in 4K. Tell us what it's been like.
Yes, maybe I explain why I decided to shoot in 4K. My most jobs or most customers are from the automobile industry, and I'm doing films for the big motor shows, and on these big motor shows you have really large LED screens. The largest I had in the last 2 years was 70 meters, so 70 meters. And it was amazing, but we were not able to put a real film on it at this time, so we had an animation film. And I thought we have to have a real film on this. And at this time, the Sony F65 was announced, and I thought that could be a challenge, a chance to bring a real movie on such big screens. And a few months later, when we get the camera, we started working on this, and it was it's not one thing to just shoot in 4K, but all the post-production was a lot of learning for us. And what you see here is a classic car, and we did just some footage to learn how to deal with it, and it was shot in the United States in a very small crew. So it was only me and my first camera assistant. We just rented a classic car and these two guys, and started doing footage. And there's one thing what you can see, or was my colleague from the BBC before mentioned, this is still out of the movie, and every picture in an Ultra-HD movie is it's like a photo. It's perfect, and you can I use this picture as a background on my computer because it's I like to watch it and I can see every detail on it. Even we didn't clean the back window just to show how every single piece of dirt you can imagine. You can see also on the grill of the car. Everything is perfectly seen, and I like to watch pictures. It's like for me watching a photo book. You can, of course, you can watch the newspapers and you have pictures in it, and you can watch a magazine. But photo books are very special. You have the chance to look at a picture for a long, long time, find details, and so that's for me the most exciting in Ultra HD, to see all the details. You see if you are on location. It's much more than for me in 3D, because here it's like watching with your own eyes. I was sitting very close to this guy. In an Ultra HD projection, you really can see all these tattoos and the kind of painting of the car inside, and you can feel the leather. It's happening like, for me, it's like 3D. And one thing we really fast decided, we most of the footage we shot in the last year, we shot it in high frame rate. So we used 50p, 60p, because on a big screen and with all these sharp images, it's absolutely necessary to have more than 25 or 30p, because otherwise it's limiting you to slow pans, and that's not so nice. So most of the projects we are doing in 50p. When we do films for the big motor shows, it's also presented in 50p. And after that, most of these films are going to television for TVCs as a commercial. And then we convert it to 25p. But on the big shows, it's absolutely necessary to have at least 50p.
And incidentally, that's one of the topics that we will be raising with our other panelists. Frame rates will be will figure in that dialogue.
And also, what we can see in this picture is we have a big latitude of exposure. It's amazing. It's I say it's up to 15 stops, which is really really amazing. And you have I don't use any more filters to get rid of highlights or so. It's the latitude of the Sony F65 is absolutely gorgeous, and I like it every time I have situations like this. I can directly film into the sun with no problems. There was another test from the first days. We just shoot some animals, and here, for everybody in our editing room, it was so amazing how you can see every detail of the fur. But I am going a little bit faster over this because we heard a lot from the BBC before. Animals or nature productions are amazing in 4K. Even I can imagine that the films are in 4K, nature films are very nice to see in cinema. Not only on TV, it will be a big pleasure to see it in big theaters. Because landscapes, mountains, it's absolutely, absolutely amazing. This is just one picture out of an Audi commercial. It's not very color graded yet, but it also, we have a lot of possibilities now to deal with the color of the car. Red was always a problem for us. Now we have such a big color space that it gives us so many possibilities later in post-production that we on the set, normally I'm a little bit curious when we're shooting a red car because of lighting and reflections, but that's no problem anymore. We can fix everything, or we can get rid of every problem in the post-production. And this is another picture. It's also about the latitude of the camera. Fire is one thing which, if you want to test a camera, just go on a barbecue and film fire. And it was, we had just this lightning from this from the fire, nothing else. And you can see, it's nothing is overexposed. Everything is absolutely perfect. That is a big advantage. You need less light, and you can be faster. on production, and you can get great pictures of fire or explosions. What we else did was we rented a helicopter and went over Las Vegas, and
doesn't everyone want to do that? Doesn't everyone want to just rent a helicopter and fly over Las Vegas?
Yeah, I did it before years ago. I did exactly the same with HD, and at this time I was amazed how many details I can see, and was absolutely happy. I think it was 2003 or 2004, and now I did it again, 2012. With the Ultra-HD camera, and this time I was surprised another time. And we did it during the blue hour, during sunset, and it's a pity that we can't see it in Ultra-HD, because you can see every light until to the horizon. It's really amazing, and when it's moving, you see all the little cars driving, and absolutely in focus. That's really, really gorgeous. And what we else did on the other side, of course, we did the sky football, but I want to test more sports. So we were filming a Thai boxing. What is the challenge? Okay, doesn't matter. And we had really less light, so I had to push the camera a lot, even if we were shooting 50p, and we pushed the camera a lot, I think, to 2500 ISO, which is a lot, and after a little color grading, it was a really nice, clear picture. And that is also a reason for me, because not all of our productions are 4K, and our clients are not paying every time for 4K, but even I don't use any other camera anymore, because even if I shoot on 4K and do a delivery in HD, it's so amazing, because it's much more sharper than I can ever get it with an HD camera. And we have absolutely no grain. After the down conversion to HD, it's like a crystal clear picture. And that's what my customers want to have. They want to have a crystal clear picture, especially Audi. It's everything is about aluminium and lightweight, and so it absolutely fits to their brand. If you have a perfect picture, and with down-converted 4K to HD, it's so amazing.
What are you working on at the moment? What's the project that's involving you just at the moment?
Yeah, just at the moment, we finished a shoot on Monday morning. It's for the new Audi A3 sedan. It's a brand new car, and it will be the world premiere will be on the Shanghai Motor Show. And therefore, we made a film, and it was in a very dark situation. It's something with dance and a dancer and the car competing each other. And after that, it will went to television.
Fantastic. Berti, thank you very, very much for your efforts these past days, the last clout of the Thai boxing. Thank you very much for your efforts the last few days. I'm sorry we weren't able to show the footage next time. come back up later on for our panel discussion, please. Can I now invite, thank you. Can I invite Barry Bassett, who I saw a moment ago. Oh, there he is. Beg your pardon, Barry. Barry is MD at VMI in London. And to describe VMI as an equipment rental company is not an adequate description. Barry, tell us a little more. And when do you want to show the film? You want to show a film?
It'll be right at the end.
Okay.
Yeah, good morning, everybody. My name is Barry Bassett. My company is VMI. We rent high-end cameras, including 4K for TV industry. This is a shortened version of an essay that I've written and uploaded, so you can see it on our website if you want. We cover some well-known productions like Poirot, Miss Marple, also Midsummer Murders, as well as many others. But full range has given us a lot of experience over the last few years. Now, I am a fan of 4K. Anybody who's read this month's Televisual will have an article entitled The Case Against 4K. This is very balanced, okay? I'm not at all against it. It's just that we need to be aware of the pitfalls of shooting in 4K as well. There are real challenges, but it does look stunning. So I'm going to talk about what is 4K, the challenges about it, and then do a case study. So we all know it's stunning. Pictures are four times greater than HD. Just in terms of the little picture, in fact, we saw it earlier, that they are so much more impressive than standard definition and high definition when seen at perfect conditions. There's lots of equipment that's currently out already. But do we need it? This is highly contentious. The Bob Zitter of retiring HBO pioneer, he said that you need to have an extremely large TV. At home, my wife only allows me to have a 50-inch TV. So if you really want to see it, TVs are going to get bigger. Happily, they are getting bigger. But Panavision, John Gault actually said that if you actually want to have better image quality, image detail, then you need to perceive edge detail. And to do that, you really need to shoot at a higher frame rate. This is already what Berti has alluded to. Otherwise, you end up shooting very high-resolution images, which have motion blur. So if you want to shoot with a higher frame rate, you can actually do that today. Okay, programs like films like The Hobbit have explored shooting at 48 frames per second and done that extremely well. And now 50 frames per second in 720 is well known. But in HD, currently all TV in HD, which is 1080, is shot at 50i, which is 25 frames per second. And we have to be a little bit careful when we talk about 4K, because 4K is not always showing the full 4K due to something called bearing or debearing, which I don't want to go into. But just be aware that some of the equipment claims out there for existing technology doesn't show you everything that you might think that it ought to. And I just want to dwell on a camera which is the incumbent champion for drama presently, the Arri Alexa. It isn't a 4K camera, but actually it can shoot in 2.9K and does so very well. And Roger Deakins shot at 2.9K Skyfall, and it looked truly fantastic using Arri RAW, and afterwards up-resed it to 4K. So worth being aware of as well. Okay, there are real challenges, and this is where I come in, because I have to advise my clients, if they want to go down the 4K route, then what do they need to be aware of? So the file sizes are enormous, and if you have to compress, what are you going to do? When I started in TV, we had LTO3, and it went to LTO4, LTO5, LTO6. So if you have to afterwards put it onto tape, you can only go back three generations. Things you really need to be aware of, especially if you want to maintain the archival value of what you're doing. So if you've got to compress, then isn't there an argument for shooting in a lower frame, in a smaller picture size, which is actually with a lower level of compression? Well, these are things people really need to think about. Now, you need to have an awful lot of money. That's not the case anymore. Sony have just launched low-cost HD TVs. Well, you show it on a laptop, but currently you can't see 4K on a laptop. It is all going to come. Recent study, in fact, some years ago, showed that people viewed TV from too far away. And this is one of the issues. If you are too far away, you can't see the full beauty of HD. So you really got to think about it. Also, we don't have the bandwidth of internet, and we don't have the right compression standards, and we don't have Blu-ray of sufficient bandwidth. It will all come. I mean, there really is no question, but there are challenges, and who's going to pay for it? And is there going to be a 4K uplift for people that go through the post-production process? So if you do it right, and you're nice and clear, you know, you can make it work, and it'll be really good. Now, I think the answer, and Tom answered this question earlier, you know, we saw it took 12 years for HDTV to come, and I think the same thing is going to happen. It will come, but if you want to shoot higher resolution, do consider shooting at a higher frame rate. And recognize that 4K and 2K are scalable, as long as the pictures are good, but there are some disadvantages in terms of additional cost. And I just want to finish on a case study, and this was shot at 4K, and it was a feature film which went for theatrical release. It was shot on a Red Epic, but they didn't have the additional money for post-production, so they finished at 2K, and this is what I want to show you.
Could we run Fast Girls, please? That was spot on for time. Fantastic.
I told you 5 minutes.
Okay. cable follower. Set.
And thanks for your contribution. We'll have you up in a moment on the panel. To Arno in the back room. Arno, can I have David Wood's slides up, please? David Wood is listed, thank you. David Wood from the EBU in Geneva was due to speak here this morning and was very, very much looking forward to being here. But his house was burgled last night, so he's had to go back this morning to, as we say in England, assist the police, but just to supervise the examination by the forensic people in Geneva. So he apologizes. But I wanted to go very quickly. He only had three slides. He was going to talk to these slides, but they are crucial. And it's something that the rest of our panel will discuss. David, in his inimitable style, headed it, you know, give it to me straight, Doc, you know, give me the bad news as well as the good news. And so far, we've mostly had good news, and it's positive, and we accept that, but there are some challenges ahead. We need affordable TV sets, that we recognize, and that's beginning to happen. We need an interface to carry the signal from the set-top box PC to the display, the famous HDMI standard, which will be fixed this year, but it isn't fixed yet. We need a format to broadcast, deliver ultra-high def, for which technical choices need to be made. For example, we need the Ultra-HD production ecosystem. And that's something which Maryline Clare-Charrier will talk to in just a moment. Ultra-HD needs to be framed. How many pictures and frames per second? This is an evolving question. And there is no, I suppose, perfect solution, but we'll address that. Today we use 24 frames for movies and 50 to 60 frames per second, depending on which country, for TV. Is there a case for 100 or 120 frames per second? Greater reality, no flicker. Can the set-top boxes process that? Can the TV sets handle that? Which is worth more? More static detail, that is more where your own eye does the work looking at a screen, or better moving pictures. The dilemma of compatibility with high definition sets, the backwards compatibility-ness of 4K. So those are some of David's questions. He also puts in a plug here for 8K, the super high vision, which is being talked about now in Japan. But that's definitely for another year for us, not today. How much does it make sense to invest a lot in Ultra HD, that is 4K? Should we wait until 8K? Topics for discussion. And that was David's contribution. Forgive me for not being able to handle his delivery as amusingly as he would. But can I now ask Maryline to come up and and tell us where she is coming from. Maryline is project leader for the Forever Consortium. She herself works with Orange Labs. Forever, the four, figure four, enhanced video experience. And if you put those key letters together, you get ever. And it's a French initiative, a very welcome initiative, to support the production and delivery of HDTV, if you like, in the back office, in the production and post-production area. Maryline, your floor.
Hello. Sorry. Hello, everyone. So I'm going to introduce the context of this consortium and project, and then I'll focus on the ultra-high definition specific part of the project. So this project is a collaborative project which is supported and funded a part of it by French government, which means we have eyes focused on us and which means all the partners have commitments. So it's good for work to be done. We have nine partners. You can see their logos at the bottom. And it's led by us, Orange Labs. So if I want to summarize in a few keywords, the goal of the project is to improve video quality experience by generalizing HD for everyone, as you know, especially for ADSL delivery like us in Orange. HD doesn't reach everyone, and mobile transmissions are not very compatible with HD at the moment. So generalizing HD, introducing ultra-high definition, and this will be done thanks to the new standard that has been mentioned before by the broadcasters called HEVC, which will replace current MPEG-4 AVC, and that my colleague from ATEME will discuss a bit more after me.
Maryline, does anyone not understand what HEVC is?
Good
point. High efficiency video coding.
Developed by both MPEG and ITU, so high efficient video coding. So to show you basically where the partners work, from on the right side production to the left restitution. So we have France Television in the consortium working on the shooting and production area, especially, and then the perceived quality with us, Orange Labs, were involved actually in a lot of parts of the project, not only leading the work, but also we have experts in Orange Labs running visual tests for a long time. They actually define the bit rates for Orange to deliver HD when HD became available. So as measurement from perceived quality, what is the bit rate that we need? So that's things we are going to do for Ultra HD also. We've got ATEME, Jean-Marc will talk later about on the encoding side. We've got Teamcast and Globecast for the delivery, so satellite and digital terrestrial television covered. And we have two academics, INSA and Telecom Paris, working on the decoder, HEVC decoder and player. And we have on the UHD part a very important partner, Technicolor, for, of course, their expertise on colorimetry. So just to show you quickly, we have work packages, so quality of experience. This is where we work a lot on ultra-high definition. We have, on the other side, HEVC, encoding and decoding. And in the middle, we have this integration part where we have we decided to challenge ourselves by doing actual premium events, three during the length of the project. So the project started in June 2012 and will end June 2015. And we are going to do the first event in May, which will be HD Live HEVC. And gradually, we hope we'll go to UHD production and delivery by the end of the project. It's a bit early to make promises, so please check on the website, follow us, and you'll have information. So now, to focus on what we're doing on ultra-high definition, we want to bring something that has a significant improvement in quality of experience, because, and here I can speak as Orange representative, not only the project leader, Orange, if we want to introduce a new service, it will have impact probably on network, on equipment. So we have to be sure that it brings something new. If it doesn't, what's the point? So quality of experience, first thing to check. We need to work with standardization committees. So we are involved in ITU, where actually a standard has been defined. For those of you familiar with these institutions, it's called the BT 2020. That was finalized, the first version, in August 2012. So it gives already parameters, but need to work on new versions. And we work also with EBU, where we have work on also, as Chris said and my friends before, on frame rates, colorimetry also. And we work on subjective evaluations at home, but also we have a partner called Doremi, that you probably know, providing cinema equipment. And we work with them on what they called alternative contents, so that's live events in cinema, not the film, live events. And we want to test and evaluate equipment as they become available. So that's the directions we gave. And now, what have we been doing so far? As you can see on the right-hand side, we've done some proper shooting already. That was with the F-65, which is to us today the best equipment so far. And you can see outside on the Bravia Sony screen some of our shootage. But the problem is that we believe we need high frame rate. And so we use it because it can do 60 hertz. And unfortunately, because mostly because of the HDMI 2.0 standard, which is not ready, we don't have on all screens the interface that can deal with such frequency. So the Bravia so far can't do it. So the sequences have been downgraded to 24 or 30. So we've tried to select the parts that are not too bad, but still you can see it's not as good as it should be. And if you can see our demonstrations, it's currently being demonstrated in NAB by one partner. It'll be demonstrated again in IBC in Amsterdam. It'll be demonstrated in Dimension 3 in Paris in June. So there we'll have screens that are smaller, but can actually do the 60 hertz. And you can see the difference. So if I have messages to give is for the frame rate, because we work in ultra high definition for TV, we don't work for movies. So TV means a lot of motion in sports, for instance. And if you, you all have seen sports on TV, the motion rendering is not good. And for us, we actually need go all the way to 120 hertz. That's what our first studies show, to get rid of all this bad motion blur or jerkiness, all these things that we want to get rid of if we want to provide a great quality of experience. So 120 hertz, we need cameras that can do that, and we need displays that can display that. So yeah, it's difficult. But again, are we ambitious? Do we want something different from HD? And as you notice, I speak a lot about ultra-high definition. I don't use 4K a lot, because 4K for us is really a first step. And we talk here about increase in resolution. But ultra-high definition is not only resolution, it's also these other dimensions that are frequency, like frame rate, and also the perception of colors. We can do so much better currently than the 8-bit depth pixel that we have. We have experiences that show how you can improve the luminance levels, how you can improve the chrominance definition. And I mean, you really see it. It's not some technical lab work. I can't have everything here, but we have proper demonstrations that show the big difference. And also the first studies we've done, and that's actually jointly with the EBU, so David Wood would probably have, I hope, say the same thing. Something important, and it's been mentioned before, it's this screen. I'm talking again about UHD at home. So currently, the standard screen size, it's about 50 inches. And studies have shown that if you want to perceive HD, you need to be sitting at about 3.2 times the height of the screen. So if you have a 50-inch diagonal screen, that means you see roughly at about 2.7 meters sort of thing. I'm checking my, 2 meters, 2.5 meters. And that's the distance which is good, because if you're closer to that, you actually see the lines definitions, which is bad. If you're too much further away, you don't see the benefit of HD. And for Ultra HD, the current measures we have from perceived quality, it's much lower, the ratio, so it's actually 1.6. So if you have a 50-inch screen, that means you're sitting at 1 meter away from the screen. That's, you're sitting on the table, the lounge table, which is not good. So what does it mean? You need bigger screens. You need probably 84 inches. And how does it feel at home? What kind of home you have for that? It's probably okay, actually. People were worried at the start, but then it's a money problem. We saw the word affordable before, and it's a good one. So frame rate, think frame rate, because motion is as important as the definition of the pixels, probably even more. We had identified it as something the users and the viewers want to have, and distance to the screen. What will the industry provide as screens?
Thank you, Maryline. Thank you very much. We'll keep any questions for the panel, if I may. Thank you. Jean-Marc, Dr. Jean-Marc Thiesse, please join us from ATEME and tell us, do you want to be from the podium?
Yeah.
Tell us a little about ATEME and what you're doing.
Thank you. So, hi everybody. I'm Jean-Marc from ATEME. We are a French-based company. We are a provider of compression solution. So from MPEG-2, AVC, and now also HAVC. So since speakers before me already said we have the two end of the chain, we are already available, we have camera, we have TV screens. There are some things to fix, but it's close to be okay. And now the big challenge is how to deliver this, so the compression. So I will address this point here. So first, so my question is how does 4K fit on current distribution architecture? So if I take a current use case, the existing distribution architecture for DTT, satellite or cable, we have a bitrate between 24 to 45 megabits. So actually, we have HD channel which are broadcasted using AVC for bitrate between 5 to 10 megabits. And in the more common satellite transponder, we have 3 to 8 HD channels. So when talking about ultra HD, we are talking about 8 times more pixels. Because we are talking about HD, which is 1,018 interlaced, and so we are in 4K. So 8 times more pixel, this leads to 8 times more bitrate. So actually, it is almost impossible to fit a single 4K TV channel in current architecture. But fortunately, there is a bad assumption between SD to HD and then going to 4K. So maybe it will be possible. So we ask the question, which bitrate ratio between HD and 4K? So we run many experiments. Here I present results using a Red Epic camera, but we also use a F65, and we have same results. So our question was how to reach the same quality, same broadcast quality for content for the three sizes, so 4K, 1080p 50 and 720p 15. So the broadcast quality is near 33 dB in PSNR. And as you can see, the broadcast application in this example, but it's the same for globally the same for all content we have tested. For broadcast application, the bitrate seems to increase approximately as a square root of the number of pixels to compress. So here, this test is using AVC. So that means that Ultra HD can be done with AVC, and it has been done, for example, in January. Since January, ATEME is partner with Eutelsat, and there is a channel on air of ultra high definition where we have a 4K ultra UHD channel using a quad HD. So we divided the ultra HD in four HD sequences and mixing this after, and then we can have we have a channel with 40 megabits, which is on air. But for massive deployment, of course, we need a new standard. And fortunately, one have been just released. So it is HEVC, as mentioned before. So HEVC stands for High Efficiency Video Coding. It's a joint standard of MPEG and DTU, which have been together on the DCTVC collaborative team. So this is a successor of AVC standard. And the goal, the initial goal of this standard was to achieve a compression gain of 50% over AVC at the same subjective quality. And with 10 times more complexity in encoder side and 2 or 3 max for the decoder side. So actually the current status is that the standard have been finalized in January. With three profile, main, 10-bit, and still picture. So it is interesting to note that 10-bit is already available. As Maryline mentioned, this can be helpful for UHD, and this has been the use case which make us create this profile right now. Moreover, for next year, the GCTVC plan to add the 422 and 444 range extension profile and also scalable and 3D. But here, it's interesting also to note that next year we will have the range extension, which can also help for the UHD introduction. So more sooner, we have the first product and services which are announced. So this week at Las Vegas at NAB, the two world HEVC and the folk and UHD are in all the encoder manufacturer stand. So UHD seems to be one of the killer applications for HEVC. I will be quick on this. It's some technical point. So to show you what are the main tool between MPEG-2 to HEVC, main things to see that we have now with HEVC larger block sizes, which are 64 by 64. This is typically useful for encoding ultra HD video. And more globally, we have increased the number of way to encode a video, and this lead to efficient. This indeed lead to the coding efficiency, which can be which can allow to encode UHD at relevant bitrate. So here is an example with the same sequences presented below. So the blue curve is using HEVC. When you are on top on the right distortion curve, it's better. So it means that with smaller bit rates, you can achieve a higher quality, or with the same bit rate, you can achieve a better quality. So here we have a 35 bit rate gain observed. So this can allow to have, for example, ultra high definition TV channel at something like 13 megabits. So we have some example of this with the content from Forever on the Sony TV outside. And you can also see a comparison between AVC and HEVC at half the bitrate. And you will see that the quality is approximately the same, or is the same. So here just an example of a difference. So HEVC, it's on the right, and AVC on the left. Here it has the same bitrate. And of course, we are better using this new standard. Thank you.
Fantastic. Thank you, Jean-Marc. Come and join us. And might I invite our other panelists back up to Maryline, Barry, and Berti. And let's spend the last few minutes looking at some of these technology challenges. Any questions from the audience for our experts, first of all? Any questions? Okay. Let's pose some questions to you. Maryline, first of all, great work on the project.
You
have France Televisions as a partner. What do they hope to achieve from the work? They are, as well as being on cable and satellite and DSL, they're also a terrestrial broadcaster, a major important terrestrial broadcaster. Do they see a day when 4K will be part of their transmission model?
That's probably what they want to check through their participation to the consortium, because we have a digital terrestrial partner, Teamcast, and France Télévisions is interested in seeing the results of HEVC, of course, because, again, that's like everyone allows to send more channels or better quality, depending on what you do with it. But they're really more involved in the ultra-high definition part. Because they want to see, like us, if the production in currently 4K, but hopefully 4K and high frame rate, will give these a better quality of experience to their final users. So we don't have actual roadmaps in mind. Somebody before in the previous session has shown a roadmap, which, 2025 maybe, because it depends on equipment. But for us, it's more... The availability of the significant improvement. So they are participating to perceived quality testing.
I think we all perhaps recognize now, keep the microphone, we all recognize that the sport, a fast-moving sport, needs a high frame rate. Now, some television manufacturers have been able to cope with 400, 500, 600 hertz, I think even more. So where's the problem? In frame rate. Where's the problem in deciding frame rate? And I'll come to you as well, Barry, in a moment. Where's the bottleneck? Where's the holdup?
I can identify two, but maybe not only. First, it's the interface. We mentioned that the current HDMI 1.4 standard to the screen is not enough to carry all the data. So that's one thing. HDMI 2.0 will do it, but it's a bit like we were expecting it mid-2013. Apparently, it will be towards the end. So that's one thing. So the few screens today on the market that can show 60 hertz, they actually have four HDMI 1.4. So you can see it's not ideal. And the other thing is for us, the delivery chain, so us, it's Orange, but also others. I mean, if you triple the number of images, and even if you have a great new standard encoding, how many extra megabits will that be? So Jean-Marc is showing some of our UHD contents encoded at like 13 to 23 megabits. But that's 4K and that's 30 hertz. And so we are studying very deeply if currently we think for the motion it needs to be at least 120 hertz. So it's much more, it's four times more than 30. Yeah. And we are studying also 10 to 12 bits. But then it's only the studies that will show us what among these parameters are the ones that are very important for the users. The ones that are not important, we're not going to keep them. So multiply by 8, 10, maybe only 6, we don't know yet, and then only we'll see the bitrate.
But broadcasters have always managed this, whether through multiplexing the signal. Sport has always been hungry for bitrate, and cartoons are not hungry for bitrate. You can relax about that. So what's different for the future? Just the demand is greater?
It's just that we went from, it was interesting, the little commercial where you see the black and white TV with the little means. And that's extremely a good way to show that, because it's a bit like YouTube at the moment. Teenagers love it and they're happy with that. So they're not the ones asking for Ultra HD. But all the people, maybe more my generation, once you see HD, I can't watch sport, which is SD, upscaled to the definition. It's just too ugly. I don't want to see that. So because I've seen a sort HD displayed on an HD screen, that's what I want to keep. And now that I can see what 4K can bring, and hopefully even better, once you realize that you can have, I don't know, like it can be basketball players, as we've seen, or soccer players or tennis men. Once you can see that they can move without having this sort of flickering effect or something blurry, you just think, that's exactly what I want to see, because if I'm there, that's what I want to see. So the keywords for the new experience, it's realism and immersion.
Yeah.
So once you taste that, I think you don't want to go back.
Exactly. Berti, what have you been doing on high frame rate, if any?
What have we been doing?
No.
I think a few people may ask, why are 24 frames in cinema okay and on television it's not okay? It's depending on, in a movie you have little depth of field, so a few things are sharp, and the DOP are taking a lot of work on capturing the motion perfect with little frame rates. So in movies, this is fine, but if you are presenting sports, you have a big depth of field, so almost everything in the picture is sharp because you want to see everything. And then you have a completely sharp picture, which is very big, and if you move very quickly, then you will have shattering effects with low frame rates. So we did tests for Sky Germany on football, and we were shooting 50p, and 30p, and 30p wasn't enough. We had a lot of pictures later in the editing we had to cancel because of this shattering effect. Yeah. And you have two chances. You do a long exposure, so if you pan fast, then everything is blurred. But that's not what you want to have if you buy an expensive 4K television, and you don't want to have a lot of motion blur. So 50p at least is for football, or I say all other sports, is absolutely necessary.
Okay, so there's no doubt in your mind.
No, for me
okay.
It's absolutely no.
Barry?
Well, I mean, ultimately, people want to make productions which deliver on the taste of what the DOP and the director want to create. And in the past, they were always very nervous about going for anything but 24 frames per second. And as things are progressing, The Hobbit, for the first time, is shot very effectively at 48 frames per second. I know that on all of the big dramas that we've been working on, the DOPs are very keen to create a very classic look with period drama, and for those, they've always been traditionally shot at 25 frames per second. So, I mean, it was said in a previous session that it's all about being content-driven and about delivering what the consumer expects. Certainly, faster frame rate gives a different look. As long as people are going to buy into that, there's no issue. But the pictures will be perceived by the viewer to be sharper if they're able to shoot the fast frame rate, which has been said lots of times.
Jean-Marc, you said, buried in your slide, that I don't know whether you were referring to 4K or 8K, you know, ultra high def or super high vision. It's going to be the killer app. Are you happy with that statement? Is it going to be the killer app?
Actually, there is another one which will be faster. It will be OTT services, HD on over the top channel. But we think that UHD is the next one and is a bigger one. And there is more business, I think, with this also.
Some people have suggested that OTT over telephone lines in 4K, forget it.
Yeah, I'm meaning HD over the top.
Okay, HD, all right, fine. Maryline, One other challenge, which maybe your forever group is not specifically looking at, but in general terms, and that's the HDMI, the consumer end of the connectivity. Any idea where we are with HDMI development?
Well, I'm looking forward to hear from my colleagues currently at the NAB in Las Vegas. But what we've seen is that, unfortunately, it's not ready now. No. And as I said, it's more towards the end of the year.
End of the year. That's what I've heard, too. So we've got a minute left, ladies and gentlemen. Any questions for these experts? Then I think we can relax. If you want to have a one-on-one dialogue with them, please grab them at the end of the session. But meanwhile, ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much indeed for your contribution this morning.
Thank you.